Welcome to Hard Talk. I'm Stephen Sackur. Italy is the European country hit hardest by the coronavirus pandemic. It took a virulent hold in northern Italy in February, and now the national death toll stands at more than 25,000. Italy's healthcare system has been stretched to the very limit, and the social and economic consequences, well, they threaten to blight the country for years to come. Maybe the rapid spread of COVID-19 in Lombardy was something to do with the aging population or the Italian way of intergenerational contact. At first, the government tried to isolate the worst affected areas from the rest of the country. It wasn't until thousands of people had been infected that Prime Minister Giuseppe Conte announced a nationwide lockdown on March the 9th.
La decisione giusta oggi è di restare a casa. Il futuro nostro dell'Italia è nelle nostre mani. Ognuno deve fare la propria parte.
Vibrant, noisy Italy was plunged into fearful silence. Except in the hospitals, which were filled to overflowing with the victims of this cruel virus, mostly the elderly and the vulnerable. The death toll exceeded 10,000 before March was out. With intensive care units full, doctors had to make desperate decisions about who to prioritize for treatment. All the while, the healthcare workers themselves were in grave danger. In one of the worst hit towns, Bergamo, staff at the Papa Giovanni Hospital warned the authorities their facility had become highly contaminated and was now a major source of new infection. One of its intensive care doctors is Lorenzo Grazioli, who spoke to me from the hospital.
I tell you that all the hospital, nurses, doctors, technicians, whoever, answer like a concert opera house, okay? And nobody, I tell you, nobody stepped down from that.
Did you ever come close to despair, to losing a sense of hope and maybe even motivation?
Well, motivation is one of the things you have not to lose. Otherwise, in this situation, you will defeated by the circumstances. There will be, in the future, when all these things will finish, the time to reflect on it. Now is not the time. Now we have to fight.
Italy's coronavirus crisis has now plateaued. The government has taken a first small step to ease the draconian lockdown, but enormous damage has been done. The country's weaknesses have been exposed. A debt-ridden, inefficient economy now faces a prolonged recession. And in the midst of economic vulnerability, there are fears of a resurgence of Italy's age-old scourge, organized crime, the mafia. One of those sounding the alarm is the veteran mayor of Palermo in Sicily, Leoluca Orlando.
I send a message starting from the south, but reaching the north. In the north, we had the first explosion of contamination arriving later in Sicily and in Palermo. The explosion of new poverty started in the south, but reached now even the north. And the mafia, the mafias, of course, try to use difficulties of the economy, tries to use difficulties of the new poor. New poor can be entrepreneur. New poor can be poor persons, traditionally poor persons. Therefore, I sent a strong message to Premier Conte, directly to him, directly to the government, saying, you have just to give us opportunity and possibility to spend as soon as possible money to fight against the new poverty.
Italy sits at the heart of Europe, but it looks much more vulnerable than many of its neighbours. Are the country's leaders capable of meeting this once-in-a-lifetime challenge? Minister Vincenzo Amendola, welcome to Hard Talk.
Thank you very much.
Italy is going through a tragedy. Your death toll as a result of coronavirus now stands at more than 25,000. You have clearly suffered more than other countries in Europe. Why do you think that is?
We saw the pandemic spreading in our country before the other country in the European ones, then followed us 2 weeks later than we started in end of February. Until now, we are working a lot. The curve already is touching the plateau, is coming down. But of course, we are concerned about some region that is still under pressure. We saw that it was necessary solidarity union among all the country at the European level, and this solidarity meant also a system of coordination for all the action and all the distribution of the medical equipment that are necessary to win this battle. So in order to go on, our country worked a lot just because we were eaten before, in order to help all the other to go out from this tunnel.
You, Minister, you talk about solidarity, and in a short while we'll talk about solidarity with the EU, but let us talk about domestic, internal solidarity first. Do you believe that your government still has the trust of your people, given the way that you've handled this crisis?
If I look the poll in terms of support to the Prime Minister Conte, they are quite positive. But we know that the reality at this particular moment, after 2 months of lockdown and a lot of sacrifice that the Italian people did, needs not to be considered as, the only elements in order to be safe. Because now the stress of our government is to boost the economy, is to support the social cohesion and a lot of people that were obliged to stay at home. Social cohesion means to help the most fragile sector of our society, means to help the country to have a resilient in this hard time and to plan the second phase, that is the recovery. And of course the recovery, the reopening is very complex. We have to take care of the health of the people, first of all, at the same moment, try to give to our society the way to go out from the sacrifice that they did in the last 2 months.
On this question of trust and being straight with your people, isn't it time to actually talk of regret, of mistakes that were made, particularly, for example, allowing that football game to go ahead, the Atalanta against Valencia game on 19th February, and then party political leaders, indeed your own party political leader, involved in a Don't Stop Milan campaign, keeping the city open, which went on right until the very end of February, when it was quite clear that a crisis was unfolding. It might be better for your relationship with the people to say, we got this wrong.
I would like to say that many political leaders, they made mistake, not just in terms of leader from the party in government, but also in the opposition. And most of them, they regret because at the beginning was not understood the powerful meaning of this spreading. Many prime ministers around Europe, then they regret many delay in action. So the initial part of the spreading was not understood very well from many countries and from many political leaders in the government, in the opposition. So it's not a question just to regret, but it's just the issue that we were confronting ourselves with something unprecedented in the history of our continent, and especially on the global level.
I understand that point. It's fair for you to make that point, but nonetheless, the Corriere della Sera newspaper has looked at, in a thorough investigation, at the failings of the national and regional governments to coordinate properly, and in particular, failures to deliver vital protective equipment to the hospitals, vital failures when it came to understanding that many of your hospitals had become breeding grounds for the virus. Do you think that there are really important lessons that you must now learn about the weaknesses in your healthcare system?
On the healthcare, if you speak about the medical equipment, means mask and ventilator, that was a problem that we had all over Europe. Because, as you know, the production and the chain of value related to this medical, particular medical equipment, unfortunately, we had to organize as European Union immediately. Italy set up a system also of national production immediately. All the European countries did it because, of course, this was an unprecedented emergency that we have to face. If you speak about the relation between the country, the government and the region, of course, there was a need of coordination because the health system is also under the leadership and the management of the region. But this particular issue, of course, didn't mean that there was lack of coordination. We should have worked and we have worked side by side to try to avoid all the particular problem.
In terms of the lockdown, the decision has been made to begin a slow process of easing the lockdown, I believe, on May 4th. How nervous are you that that could bring a second wave, a new wave of spread of the virus?
But this is a huge point that we are working not just on the national level, but also at the European level. We need to have an exit strategy, as the European Commission proposed, and we have to do all together. Because we don't know until we are not going to have the vaccination available how it's possible to defeat completely the COVID-19. So the second phase, the reopening, could not be fast, should be slow, should be well organized, means some chain of value to reactivate it and some industry and manufacturer company that can start to work like some they are already doing, means they have also to reorganize in terms of security, internal health protection in the fields of work. So it's a slow process that we are going to deliver already in the next week because we have to be prepared much more in advance than the 4th of May.
I mean, you're Europe Minister and the Italian flag stands proudly alongside the European flag in your office, but do you honestly think the European Union gets it when it comes to the scale of Italy's problems right now? Your economy is devastated. Your industrial production number went down by more than 16% in March alone. You are facing a profound economic crisis now. You talk of solidarity with Europe, but do you see any real signs of EU solidarity and understanding?
I see it. I have to be honest. I saw not just in the apology that Ursula von der Leyen, Charles Michel, the president of the European Council, did it because at the first part of the spreading of the COVID-19, there was not, let's say, a clear action towards Italy. But then something moved. European Commission took a initiative in terms of economical help. The European Central Bank intervened in order to support the resilience of the European economy.
Your former Prime Minister Enrico Letta, a couple of weeks ago, he said that he worried that the European Union was showing signs of the Trump virus, that it was a question of Germany first, Belgium first, Netherlands first, rather than true community united spirit. Many Italians today still believe that is true.
But many Italians, of course, when they saw this tough period that we were going on, of course, they were asking for more Europe, Europe intervention. And I think that I know that this feeling of dissatisfaction is coming also from the fear of some adventure that Europe did in the past. We still have in mind the last economical crisis that we lived 10 years ago, while Europe didn't react immediately. I think that European Commission, European Central Bank and European Council took decision in 4 weeks that probably in the past we spent 4 years to wait on. So what we are having now is a common and coordinated response that is helpful because we think that no country can manage alone. because we have not a financial crisis on the stock exchange. What we have now is a crisis of the chain of value, of the real economy in terms of production, in terms of distributing, in terms of export that is linking all the 27 countries.
Indeed, Minister. I understand you're trying to put a positive spin on it compared with some of your Italian colleagues, but nonetheless, the reality is that your Prime Minister, Mr. Conte, has insisted that in the end there must be debt sharing through the form of some sort of so-called corona bonds. That is, that the entire EU, including the richest countries like Germany, should take on, assume some of the debt burden that now sits on countries like Italy. The Germans have repeatedly said no, and they didn't say yes even in the summit yesterday. So why are you being so positive?
No, this is not a correct, let's say, report from the meeting of yesterday. I'm not positive because I'm Euro-optimistic. I'm, let's say, I have a realistic approach to what we are living and what we have to do. And yesterday we agreed on some big step forward. Three fiscal tools that were already, let's say, agreed yesterday in terms of delivering before the 1st of June.
Maybe, Minister, Italians look at the story of Greece over the last few years and they see that in the future, Italy's existence in the EU is going to be very, very miserable. Because however you look at it, your national debt, as a result of what has happened in the recent months, is going to spiral way beyond the 2.5 trillion euros it stands at. Your national debt is going to be 180% of your national income very soon. That's what the experts say. And as long as that is the case, your future in the Eurozone is going to be miserable.
I think your prediction is quite miserable in the sense that what we saw from the history of Greece and the last crisis that we lived was a big lesson that we learned as Europeans. Indeed, for this reason, between March and now, we took many more decisions that were taken 10 years ago, just in four years. So many recovery was done also in terms of unity. Of course, there are 27 national interests that they have to find a compromise. But we know that for this particular crisis, we have to be united.
You keep telling me about solidarity and you're giving me the technical reasons why you believe the EU is doing what is necessary for Italy. But look at the public opinion. Look at the public opinions, Minister. In your country, I'm looking at a couple of polls. One survey, 59% of Italians said the EU no longer makes sense. In another poll, Italians described China as a better friend of the country than Germany. This is the reality of your politics today. Italians have fallen out of love with the EU, and your political opponents on the right in Italy are making huge political capital right now.
I know, but I'm not speaking about another reality. I know I have concern about this feeling about the European Union. But as a politician, we have to look at the reality and to have a vision. Our country, like each European country, without this alliance, alone in front of a global pandemic like this, pushing a huge risk to all the sector of the society, can be lost. Unity in European Union nowadays means also defend the national interest. I know that is not at this particular moment, because there is fear, there is rage, could be something not so popular. But in the mid and long term is the only way to defend the national
interest.
Well,
you must be a great optimist, because you know better than me that your government is fragile. You represent a centre-left party, but you also know that the League party on the right, led by Mr. Salvini, is many points ahead of your party and the other coalition parties in the opinion polls. If there is to be an Italian election in the coming months, it looks very likely that the League and its other allies on the extreme right will take control in Italy. That, to many Europeans, is a source of real concern.
My big concern nowadays is to protect the country for the pandemic that is living, to protect the country and the people that they are making sacrifice, and to start the recovery. Then we are going to discuss about political future, political option, and so on. Nowadays, our concern is another. I know that many people like about prediction for the next election, but this is not the main concern that they have.
But my point is about powerful messaging. When Mr. Salvini said this just a couple of weeks ago, first we are going to defeat the virus, then, he said, we are going to have a big rethink on Europe. And if it helps, we will say goodbye to the EU without even a thank you. That's the message that's getting through to many Italians.
But this is a clear political message. I mean, there are options. There are people support European Union alliance in order to change it, to strengthen it, to make it more resilient, to update it, because we see that the risk and the opportunities that we are living nowadays on the global level are changing. Some others, they think, like it happened also in UK, that going out from the alliance is a better choice.
One final thought, and I've been speaking to the mayor of Palermo, Leo Luca Orlando. He's been in that position for many years. He says that such is the economic hardship as a result of this coronavirus in Sicily. He worries that the organized criminals, the mafia, are going to make a big comeback. He says a den of mafia jackals is now ready to exploit the new poor. There is a great risk here of an alliance cemented by despair. How can your government ensure that doesn't happen?
We're working on it. We are working together with the judges that are on the front line to fight against mafia. This is a concern that we are really very aware. Leo Luca Orlando is right. And we are working because all the measures that we are having now in terms of support, also the people, the company, the entrepreneurs, means that, of course, they have to be channeled in a correct way and never, ever pay the risk to some infiltration of the illegal organization. So this is a concern that is really aware for us, for the system of the bank system, for all the government that is involved in this social protection action that is in place.
We've talked about the health crisis. We've talked about the economic crisis. How long, in your view, is it going to take Italy to recover from what has happened?
But in terms of course, defeating the COVID-19, as we know, as on the global level, on the World Health Organization is mentioning, we're going to defeat this disease when there will be the vaccination. The European Union is having also a line of budget spending now in order to boost the research against the vaccination. There are many company network of researchers that are working all over Europe. So the first point that we have in agenda is to defeat with the vaccination all the risk. In terms of economical recovery, in terms of social cohesion, we are working side by side all the 27, because stronger is this solidarity, faster will be also the resilience and the recovery of the internal market union, the competitiveness of European Union in front of the world, and also the capability of our industry and chain of value to recover in terms of export. So we know that we have to make a walk that will be long. European Commission, Central Bank, they are with us, and now the 27 are moving all together.
Minister Amendola, I thank you very much indeed for joining me on HARDtalk.
It was a pleasure. Thank you very much.